Good evening. Hi, I'm a teacher with the TDSB. My name is Nicole, and I've lived in Maine for about 14 years. I see a lot of disenfranchised youth. There are more gangs, it seems, than there ever were before. I think 2005 was the year of the gun. It appears as though we are going in that direction once again. And, you know, finally we're getting a community center after 25 years. But the reality is that, you know, there's no jobs. There's nothing for our kids to do, period. And what is the police service going to help out in terms of helping our youth get back on track?
You know, and that's a very good point. And I think the key to success is people have to understand that policing is only one element of community safety. There's only one entity, and that's the enforcement piece. But one of the things that we think that is very important is that we need to strengthen our relationships with other agencies and other entities that are out there. And I will tell you that the vast majority of young men and women are good, law-abiding people. They're very smart, they're very progressive, and our future does look good. I come to these town halls, but I also go to many award ceremonies, and some of the things that our young men and women do are fantastic. Now, I will say that there is a small segment, and I do say small segment, that are high risk, and unfortunately, the decisions that have been made are not the best decisions. So we need to work with agencies. Success isn't on how many people we arrest. Success is on what can we do to give people positive role models? What can we do so that when a young man decides to use a gun to answer a dispute, what can we do to get in front of that so that those decisions are made better? And so we have the hubs that we've put in. We've expanded on that. We've looked at diversion programs. We're increasing that. And we're looking at trying to put the right resources in the right places at the right time so that better decisions are going to be made. And so there is a stronger methodology in policing that doesn't look at behavior, but looks at root cause of behavior, and that's where the other agencies come in. Why is that person doing that? Is it because they're newly assimilated to the country? Is it because they do not have a job? Is it because they have a drug dependency? Is it because of mental health? Get those primary agencies in front, because enforcement doesn't have to be the answer as the forefront to all of these solutions. And so those are the things that we're looking at to align better, and those are things that I'm excited about.
Great, thank you. Okay,
Anderson. Chief Saunders. In regards to the news release tonight, if in the report there's some sort of effect on our particular division, 12 division, whether it's the TAVIS program or whether it may be a collapse of the actual division, because rumors say that there may be some divisions that may be closed, will you come back and explain to us why it affected our area?
Oh, absolutely. The interim report is exactly that. The final report is where we are actually going to be moving towards what we're going to be doing. And there has to be strong consultation. If we don't add value to what we're doing, then we're not going to be successful. And part of that value piece is listening to the community. And so you'll get a better understanding tomorrow. It's not just my report. There are other stakeholders involved. And we have all agree that there's going to be a launch, and I can't step in front of that, nor would I, because a tremendous amount of time and effort was put into this report. And when you read the report, then we'll have that opportunity. It's very hard to have a one-way conversation when I'm talking to people about something that I know about, but you're only getting snippets, you know? And so this will provide that opportunity. When you get it, you read it, and then we come back to the table, and we have those hard discussions. We have to have those.
Okay.
Thank you.
Well,
and then we'll come back to this one. Okay? I've been doing some work with Frances in our community in Queens. One of the issues that she brought up was these pay for cash stores that are now sort of operating along with sort of almost every other store. And, you know, sort of our neighborhood seems to be a guinea pig to see how these, you know, these sort of opportunistic businesses come in and really sort of tear the fabric of families that are already in unfortunate circumstances. And now with the government legalizing marijuana, I'm afraid that it may happen again in this neighborhood. It hasn't yet. It's obviously been called into the Dine area. It's the
are the bylaws in place to stop having a store, you know, a pot shop at every corner, and you know, the rules to buy and sell are so vague. And I do fear that this is a community that could be another section where that will happen again.
I mean, I can talk from an enforcement capacity, but when it comes to the city and allowing it to happen, that's another entity, and you'll have that opportunity to have that discussion with them. The law of the day is pretty straightforward. The only way that you can sell is if Health Canada gives you a license. That's it, right now. And so the enforcement piece is, and I've been very clear on this, and I'll remain clear on this, that the users, I'm not interested in, but the ones that are getting monetary gain for this gap that is existing right now, those are the ones that I'm going after, because I have problems with, I don't want to be on the other side of the conversation. I'm having problems with it. When you look at the edibles, when you look at the choo-choos, and you look at the lollipops, and you look at the brownies, and all these things that are out there, and they're not regulated. Nobody knows who makes it. Nobody knows how much THC is in those items. Just because a number is put on it, it doesn't mean that it exists. Nobody knows the quality of it, how it's made, whether or not it has mold or not, which is one of the characteristics when you're growing on your own and a concern, a health concern, a major health concern with a lot of consumption over a long period of time. The government has regulations. It is regulated. So they have the ability of explaining exactly what the THC quantity is, exactly the environment that it's made in. And it's not blood money, because the black market is blood money. People are getting killed over and over. And so they're getting it from illegal locations. Just because a person's in a suit and tie selling it, and they're going under the guise of, you know, this is for medicinal purposes. Anyone that has a prescription for medicinal marijuana knows the system from the way it was obtained. It is through Canada Post. That's the only way. So if you see a dispensary, if you ask them if Health Canada gave you a license, the answer is going to be no. And if they say yes, it's because they're lying. And if Health Canada hasn't given you the license, it's illegal. And if you're trafficking, we're still going to be taking it before the courts. I've spoken with the federal prosecutors. This is not a waste of taxpayer money. If I didn't enforce and some 12-year-old eats a brownie and winds up in the hospital, then I'm in another conversation with the public. And it's not a good one, because I've received a lot of complaints on that. So it's a vicious cycle. Nobody's going to win at this point in time. But the government is taking its time to get the proper regulation in place, because they understand that this is very tricky. This is very complex, and you don't want to unring that bell, because you can't. So they want to make sure they get it right. And so that's what the delay is right now. But from an enforcement capacity in Toronto, it's illegal to sell.